Blessed is our God, always now and forever, to the ages of ages.
Like in the burnt offering, the sacrifice of God, the broken spirit, God, will not despise. of righteousness and oblation and hope and confidence, and they shall all compose under altar.
Most holy Theotokos, save us with many temptations surrounding me, searching for salvation, and I have hastened unto you, Mother of the Word and ever Virgin, from all distresses and dangers deliver me.
Most holy Theotokos, save us, the souls of the passions are shaken me, my soul to its limits has been filled with much despair. Be so faithful in the fullness of your own Son and your God, all blameless one.
Glory to the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, to God and the Savior you give birth. I ask you, O Virgin, from the dangers deliver me, for now I run to you for refuge with both my soul and my reason. Bearers in your great peacefulness, it was you who bore the guiding cord, and you of faith, the cloud of my sinfulness, O bright of God, with the brightness of your advent. For you brought forth the light, the divine which was before all time.
Now and forever, and through the ages of ages, amen.
Sophia, Orthia, Cusmen, Quayo, Evangelium, Ieritio.
Yeah.
Dei, Jesus Eonas, do meu honor.
Amém.
Holy Theotokos, save us, as you will, O our Savior, to dispense our salvation through your economy inside the Virgin's womb. Show to all the people that she was our guardian. O the God of our fathers, blessed are you, our God. Bodiless angels, you do me mad. Beseech of Theotokos, for God's mercy on us.
Justice and have mercy on us.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
sake, for them, open all the ends of the earth, for those who are far off upon the sea. Show compassion, also, Master, on our many sins and have mercy on us. You are merciful, loving God, to you we ascribe the right to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever, to the ages of ages.
Amen.
Glory to you, our God, glory to you.
Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, both now and ever, to the ages of ages. Amen. Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy, Father, bless.
May he who sent down the all-holy Spirit as tongues of fire upon his disciples and apostles, Christ our true God, through the intercessions of all immaculate and all blameless women of the holy glorious and praise of the apostles, the holy glorious triumph of martyrs, of our righteous and God-bearing fathers, of the holy righteous ancestors of God, of the translation of the relics of St. Theodore the General, Melania the righteous, Anastasius, the new martyr of Constantinople, Theophanes, the new martyr of Constantinople, and of the holy martyr Calliope, whose memory we commemorate today, and of all the saints of mercy, us and save us, praise the universal God, who loves mankind. Please be seated. Sometimes it's easier understand how something can be can be ignorant rather than think that they were deliberately going against God. It's more helpful for me in many cases in my life to believe that there is a unintended ignorance, just for the sake of somebody that is doing so much wrong, according to what we know of the scripture and according to what we know of God, that it's easier for me to believe that they're just ignorant of it than to believe that they are deliberately trying to, in a cause for good, be so brutal and angry and mean and nasty. We see a lot of that in the world. And it's important for us as we go through the world to just understand that not everyone has heard the gospel. Just that. There are some people who are Christian that haven't truly heard the gospel. Or at least profess that they are Christian. That haven't truly heard the gospel. Not really. Not that. Not that there's a man that died. They may have heard that there's a man that died, but, you know, oh, that just means that my salvation is taken care of and I don't have to do anything. That's not the gospel. I'm sorry, it's just not the gospel. I mean, it's a part of the gospel that Jesus Christ died for us. That's what St. Paul says the gospel is, right? I mean, I preach nothing but Christ and him crucified. He didn't even talk about Jesus resurrected. He said, I preach nothing but Christ and him crucified. So, you know, if he's not even getting to the resurrection, you know what the gospel is to St. Paul. Pick up your cross and follow him. That's what the gospel is. And you know he did it in his life. And you know he did it in his life. He's always giving people something new. Do this, don't do this, don't walk this way, don't walk this way. Make sure whenever you come together, you do it like this. Make sure you're not neglecting this. Make sure, you know. He's always got this stuff, these not rules. You can look at them that way if you like. They're not rules. They're guidelines. They're things that you can, that'll help you. There are things that can kind of direct your path. A rule, it's hard to command it, right? You can't blot it out. That's not what St. Paul does. Sometimes he does. I mean, sometimes he does. No. If this man doesn't listen to you, you better take my spirit and kick him out. Like, that's a rule. Get rid of him. But then a lot of times, this, and you're going to come up with a decision that I'm going to help you come up with, but do it using the Spirit, do it in this way. So when we look at the gospel, the true gospel of Christ, which is that he is crucified and resurrected, we have to understand that that the evil we see is not a byproduct of the gospel. In fact, it's a byproduct of the complete ignorance of it. Or if you're not ignorant and you've actually heard the gospel, then it's a complete rejection. And we have to also acknowledge that whenever we sin, when we go against God, we are also rejecting that gospel. That's what we're doing. And not to be judgmental to anyone else, when we see the evil over there, we are supposed to remember ours. We're not supposed to remember theirs. We look at their evil and we say, okay, that's evil, but I got to focus on me. If they want my help, I'll give it to them. Because that's what Jesus tells them they're supposed to do. Go find my brother and try to correct him. If they don't want my help, and they're not a part of the church, the community that you can take to them and try to intervene on them, you know, get back away from this. And focus on yourself and just say, okay, you know, I wasn't the chosen vessel to bring them to Christ at that moment. And maybe it's because I'm deficient. Okay, so now what do I have to do? It's not about that. It's about your life with God and praying for them and trying to help them as best as you can. But we got to turn the table when we're looking at sinfulness and look at ourselves. See, it's easy when we read stories like we read today at St. Cagliopoli, you know, who was martyred during the reign of Emperor Decius, right? I mean, Decius, he was, you know, just like all of these other guys. Superstitious beyond belief, and when something went wrong, blame the Christians. That's, you know, they call us the atheists, right? It's ridiculous. So, you know, it's easy to look at them. Look at Diocletian. Look at Domitian. Look at Nero. Look at all these guys, Marcus Aurelius. But, you know, look at it all. Look at all of them, and say, Constantine got it right. Well, not completely. He became a Christian eventually. But he wasn't completely correct either, even though he's the saint. And this is not a judgmental spirit coming out of me to say that. It's just clear from his life. We have to focus on the confidence in that gospel. The thing that causes the martyrs of the church to look up at somebody else and say, you know, no, that's not it. You know, that they can look at a person and believe, oh, I believe in your Christ. Absolutely, I believe in your Christ. But I also believe in Zeus, Apollo, this, blah, blah, blah. But I believe in your Christ. I believe everything that gospel says. No, really, you don't. Excuse me. But, you know, you just have to understand that it's not up for negotiation. But we don't have to get all hot about it. It's to recognize our sinfulness. That's why I'm saying. Same all of it, because we're going to continue to be under the spotlight. Orthodox is not going to stay blind from everyone's consciousness forever. People are going to know about Orthodoxy, and they're going to come after us for things that are within our faith. They're going to do it. And we have to be ready not to defend, argue, fight, claw. No. That's not us. That's not who we are. The church needs no defense. We calmly speak. Okay, you're coming at me with all these things. Would you like me to answer, or are you already ready for an argument? If you're already ready for an argument, I'm going to back away. Because I'm not getting into an argument. I will tell you what we believe. You choose to believe it or not. Now, I'll tell you why each and every one of those things that you're bringing to us are not valid reasons to dismiss us as Christians, which is what people are trying to do. It's silly. I mean, I can't even believe that I'm saying this out loud. People are trying to dismiss us as Christians, calling us idolaters and all kind of crazy stuff. We got to back away from that stuff. Those hot-tempered booms. Why do we have to back away? Because I used to be one of them. I didn't want to be around them. I just didn't want to be around you. If I was coming after you, Lord have mercy. You got to back away from that. You look at Calliope, what did she do when she was being tortured? She just stood there. She wept when she was in pain. And then Christ healed her. That's it. She was beaten. Her skin was stripped from her body because of all the craziness that was taking place. Her breasts were cut off. I mean, crazy things that St. Calliope had to endure. All simply because she wanted to believe in him and no one else. Pray to him, worship him. Diamond, right? Hit my limit. No more gods in my life, just him. Everyone else that I surround myself with, Panagia and the saint, I surround myself with them because they also worship me. That's it. I'm joining their prayer, and I'm praying with them, and I'm asking them to pray along with me. That's what this service that we do with Paraklesis is. So, we have to understand that in that moment for St. Calliope, when she's standing before Theseus, not making a defense, it doesn't, when you read the Synax Theseus, which is the most, one of the more complete lives of the saints, she still only gets a few paragraphs. That's all she gets. There's not much to say. And it starts at the point where she was martyred. It talks about her torture. And then it talks about after they couldn't torture her adequately enough, they beheaded her to kill her because their tortures weren't doing anything. They weren't changing her faith. In fact, as you can probably imagine, the more they torture a Christian and that Christian is being healed and enduring, the more it's proving him. So they had to end it. That's why so many of them ended by their heads being severed. And don't get me wrong, you can talk about beheading as a means of death. And that's absolutely accurate. But we already believe in a God more powerful than this. That if he wanted to keep St. Calliope alive, even with her head severed from her body, he could do it. But as a wise man once told me, when a person has given themselves over that much to anger and hatred and violence, God is actually helping them to destroy their souls even further. Drawing out the torture. So it's for the executioner's sake that he allows these martyrs to die. Because all that they're doing is sealing their fate more and more against God. They're not getting repentance out of it, which is what the torture is supposed to do. The torture is supposed to turn the tormentor into the child of God. Which is why he keeps healing them, right? Why so many took in so many tortures, people were coming to Christ. But at some point, God looks at the emperor, looks at the executioner, looks at the torturer and says, no, you're doing too much damage. And he allows the saint to die. For us, we have to have that discernment. When people come and start talking about Orthodoxy in a specific way, what is it that I'm about to say? How am I about to say it? Am I saying this truly with the love of our Lord? Or am I saying it with the love of the Lord with whips and overturning tables, which is you know, righteous anger for sure, but we don't have that. We don't have that righteous indignation. We don't have that. We're not capable of that. Our responses should not be in anger if we can avoid it, because it's very hard to avoid sin when we get angry. So, our Lord today is to mimic the saint. The saint only needed to make a defense out of anger, maybe in a little bit sweat. But most of the time, done in fervent love for God. And fervent love for the person that they're talking to, even if that person is there. That's hard to do. And until we truly master that, it's better to just let our action of love be the gospel, the witness of the gospel. Which is why so many of our missionaries go out into the mission field and they don't preach with words, they preach with their action. So keep these things in mind, because we're going to have a week coming of martyrdom of action, witness of action. And it's not going to come in the form of us teaching and preaching about our faith. No, it's going to come in the form of serving food. Helping as best as we can to make everyone enjoy their time while they are in our presence. It's a different kind of witness, but it can be effectual if Christ is at the bottom. If Christ is not at the bottom of it, if love in Christ is not at the bottom of it, these things in mind. Blessing and prayers and intercessions upon Ikea be with our families. And and that through her intercessions, may our Lord visit us. I will just call to our attention that Saturday evening is the Vespers service of All Saints. It will be happening in our sister parish of All Saints in the evening on Saturday. In Weirton, there will also most likely be a service for All Saints in Canonsburg, and it is their festival this week, because it always precedes ours. So, no fasting this week, so you can still catch some food down at the festival if you want to tonight, or Thursday or Friday as we're closing out the week, so just keep those things in mind. And we're raring to go for the feast day of All Saints, which will take place this Sunday. We will be celebrating here. I'm hoping in the future that they'll come for Pentecost here and we'll go to All Saints there. In the future, hopefully that will be something that we can share with our sister parish. I think that would be a nice thing. So may the blessing of the Lord be with you. Thank you, of course, for your prayers this evening and your supplications on behalf of your family.